your chance to win 6 months subscription to a leading aviation magazine and a Wings goodie bag, can you answer the following question? In which year did the Royal Air Force fight the Battle of Britain? Was it A, 1939, B, 1940, or C, 1944? All correct answers will be entered into our grand prize draw for the chance to win two VIP tickets to the 2004 Great Vintage Flying Weekend. This prize includes a flight on a vintage plane. So press red now on your digital satellite remote or visit the web at discoverywings.co.uk/win. Aviation Century, celebrating 100 years of powered flight.
Welcome to a night of Wings programming, celebrating the past 30 years of supersonic passenger flight, a time that will be remembered as the Concorde era.
It's faster than a rifle bullet, on the edges of space.
It appeals to both sides of the brain, the scientific side and the artistic side.
You can see all these 747s 20,000 feet below you. You are going 800 miles an hour faster than they are.
It's a fast jet front, an airliner main cabin.
We had some incredible experiences. Everybody would find Concorde fitted somewhere.
It's such a beautiful, powerful show.
Farnborough, southern England in the early 1960s. And at the British Aircraft Corporation hangar, a new and revolutionary project was being undertaken. After an historic agreement had been reached in 1962 between the British and French governments, the stage had been set for the design and production of an aircraft that was to push the boundaries of technology. A high-speed dawn in civil aviation had arrived, the Concorde era.
Machines and men, human brains and electronic brains, working together so that airline passengers of the 1970s can fly in confidence and in comfort far above the earth and at twice the speed of sound.
The dream of building a supersonic aircraft had become a reality, and with it came significant problems. The first to design a streamlined delta-shaped wing suitable for both subsonic and supersonic flight, and the second to design an engine that could operate across the vast speed range. The wing would incorporate many subtle dips and curves that would enable the air to flow over its surfaces efficiently, providing lift while reducing drag. With the limitations of 1960s technology, the designers were to invent hundreds of preliminary delta-shaped designs before finally homing in on the now familiar shape of Concorde. After perfecting their new wing using a model in a Mach 2 wind tunnel, the designers would turn to their second major task, the engines.
The airplane travelled at 1,350 miles an hour, but the engines could only take air at 500 miles an hour. So we had to slow the air down as it went toward the engine. And we did this by the intake system and adjustable ramps inside the intake. As the air came in, supersonically, it hit these ramps, and that generated some shock waves, which both slowed the air down and created compression inside the intake. And that intake system made Concorde the success that she was.
While the British engineers worked on the engine design, their French counterparts in Toulouse studied the effect of stress on the aluminium airframe at high-speed flight.
This instrumented model is used to establish the characteristic vibration modes in the airframe structure. High-intensity sound waves generated by Concorde's four Olympus engines could induce fatigue in the adjoining airframe structure. To make sure this doesn't happen, Concorde test specimens are bombarded with noise unlimited. This is just one example of the scale and complexity of new facilities needed and supplied to solve Concorde problems.
With the basic testing complete, in both Bristol and Toulouse, the airframes were starting to take shape, paving the way for taxi trials and an historic moment.
Thank you.
On the 2nd of March 1969 in Toulouse, in front of the world's press, prototype Concorde 001 took to the skies for the first time. Concorde had become a reality.
I think it's a great tribute to the designers of the aeroplane that they got it right first time. We did practically nothing in terms of technical alteration to Concorde during the time that she was flying. Yes, we changed the cabin in the interior four times and updated that to meet modern desires and trends. But the designers and the engineers got it right first time, and because it wasn't broke, we didn't have to fix it. And that really is a significant achievement.
The legacy of Concorde's first flight was to become an everyday occurrence as it graced the skies. For the next 34 years, flying Concorde was to remain as exhilarating as on that historic first day. Heathrow Airport and Concorde lined up for a sporty departure.
Any moment now, he's going to open up the four Rolls-Royce Olympus engines to full power and the reheats will cut in. 3, 2, 1, now! You can hear the roar increasing as she accelerates through 150 miles an hour. 250, and she rotates and lift off. Concorde climbing away to New York. She'll be there in just over 3 hours.
Shortly after takeoff, the crew would undertake a noise abatement procedure, whereby the reheats would be cut and the power reduced by 15%. The plane would then fly subsonic over land to a point just over the sea, just south of Wales. Once clear of the coastline, the crew would relight the afterburners and apply full power once more, accelerating Concorde through the sound barrier, reaching a maximum speed of around 1,300 miles per hour, twice the speed of sound, some 10 miles high.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, Captain Chris Norris, cruising along now, 26,000 feet at just under the speed of sound. We're estimating arrival in New York, touching down around 10 minutes past 9.
A few minutes later, as Concorde passed through the speed of sound, the only indication of this milestone, a small flicker on a pressure gauge, picked up the shock wave from the pitot tube on the nose of the aircraft. While the mark meter confirmed the aircraft's speed, the crew scanned the instruments to ensure that everything was set correctly for the supersonic cruise.
If you travel in a fighter aeroplane at this speed, you'll be sitting in a pressure suit, breathing through an oxygen mask, whereas our passenger sitting back there, drinking champagne, flying at more than twice the speed of other aeroplanes, nearly 2.5 times the speed of other aeroplanes, considerably higher up than other aeroplanes, and it is again unique. It's the only aeroplane capable of such performance. Until recently, we weren't quite the highest people on the planet because there was the Mir station, which had astronauts up in space, but now that that is no longer there, the people on this aeroplane today are actually the people furthest above the planet.
As Concorde flew at supersonic speeds, the friction on the outside of the airframe increased. To counter this, the plane flew into the stratosphere, where the air was thinner, reducing drag from the denser air at lower altitudes. The other major advantage of cruising at between 50 and 60,000 feet was that nothing else got in the way.
Our position at the moment is that we're at 45 degrees north and 57 degrees west. That means that we are to the south of Newfoundland and Nova Scotia in Canada. We obviously choose a routing that keeps us over the sea because that means we can stay supersonic all the way to our final descent into New York.
With two distinct supersonic tracks known as Sierra Mike and Sierra November, Concorde was kept clear of land for as long as possible. With practically no winds at these altitudes, Concorde's overall journey time rarely varied by more than a few minutes each day.
The restriction coming into New York is that we have to be subsonic before we cross the coast, but we in fact choose to do a routing that keeps us off the coast right until we get to Kennedy Airport, so we can stay supersonic right up until the point where we have to start slowing down in order to make our landing. And the way we slow down is whatever height we've got to on the Atlantic crossing, we hold that height, bring the speed back to about 1.5 times the speed of sound, and then we start descending and also continue slowing up back to the realms of subsonic flight where we mix in with the other subsonic aeroplanes and become just like any other aeroplane landing at Kennedy Airport, controlled by air traffic in New York.
Aka 580, Kennedy Tower, course and wake turbulence upon Concorde, runway 31 left, taxi into position, all next arrival is 13 miles out.
As this Concorde started its approach to land at Kennedy Airport, three other of these supersonic airliners were already in the vicinity. With both BA and Air France operating daily, JFK saw more Concordes than any other airport in the world. With many residential areas surrounding Kennedy Airport, Concorde, together with older, noisier versions of subsonic jets, was confined to certain runways and an unusual departure and arrival pattern known as the Kanazi. As this final, tightly curved approach edged ever closer, the flight engineer pumped fuel from tanks at the back of the aircraft to ones at the front, balancing Concorde's centre of gravity. As it approached the runway, Concorde would be pitched back because of limited lift under its delta-shaped wings, resulting in a greater nose-up angle than other planes. To counter the restricted view caused by this unusual approach, the nose and visor had to be lowered to their maximum drooped position in order to give the crew an unrestricted view forward. As the aircraft touched down at 180 miles per hour, the combination of reverse thrust and powerful brakes brought the Concorde to a mere walking pace in a matter of around 30 seconds. 3 hours and 13 minutes after departure from Heathrow, and in real terms an hour and a half earlier than before they left, the passengers aboard this Concorde flight already had the Big Apple in their sights. The price tag for the luxury of arriving before you leave was not cheap, at over 40 times the price of the cheapest ticket on a jumbo. Not surprisingly, the majority of passengers on board were highly successful business travellers, for whom time was literally money.
There's no question it saves not just the hours of the day, it saves the days of the week by making day one an effective one on the other side of the Atlantic.
Really, I suppose, everybody was a businessman in one sense or another. Either they were businessmen in the sense that you and I would think about it, or they were sports stars, actors, pop stars, classical musicians, people to whom time was money.
Midday, arrive 10 o'clock in the evening, Europe time, and go to work on day three back in Europe. Marvellous.
After a short 3.5 hour flight and a 24-hour break downtown, the only drama ahead for the crews returning home the following day was the challenging Kanazi takeoff from JFK. All pilots had to perfect this tricky manoeuvre on a regular basis in the simulators at Bristol and Paris.
So off come the brakes. 3, 2, 1, now. We open the throttles up and slam them open. It's just a computer input. The reheats light up. The aeroplane starts to accelerate. At 182 tons, acceleration is already better than probably your motor car. We're traveling at 75 miles an hour, starting to increase speed towards the point where we're going to check the engines are functioning correctly. That's 100 knots, power checked. So we continue to go on up towards a speed where we make a decision to commit to the takeoff. That's called V1. Here we are coming up to that speed now, V1, and approaching the speed where we'll rotate the aeroplane to the climb out attitude. As rotate's called, I pull back on the control column, pitching Concorde up to about 13 degrees. Shortly after that, we're airborne, positive climb, gear up, turn, roll on 25 degrees of bank. You get an excellent view out of the left-hand side of the aircraft right here as we turn out over the Jamaica Bay, accelerating up to 250 knots as we approach the noise time. 3, 2, 1, noise, reduce the power and switch off the reheats. Cross over the bridge, and there we are.
New York's JFK Airport has been synonymous with Concorde since 1976. A total of 42 of the jets would fly in and out of JFK every week, the majority of which would be seen first thing in the morning. With a powerful environmental lobby living close to the airport, noise sensitivities were high on JFK's agenda. Ironically, Concorde would often benefit from strict noise enforcement by taking off from an empty, less sensitive runway while everybody else had to queue. As the regular transatlantic flights departed for Europe, the morning eastbound Concorde, taking off around the same time, would land at their destinations, Paris and London, when the subsonic jets were still only halfway across the Atlantic.
You are going 800 miles an hour or thereabouts faster than they are. And you just sort of look at them down below and they literally go back like this and you sort of wave bye-bye. It was that sort of extraordinary feeling that you weren't moving at all, that you were just hanging suspended in space and waiting for Mother Earth to spin around and for your destination to arrive, and you then pull the throttles back and re-entered and descended and came into land. It was an amazing feeling.
Concorde was exhilarating to fly, but was technically much more complicated to get underway than other aircraft. With all four engines powered up, the crew had to undertake a complex checklist, reviewing everything from electrical systems to the flying controls. Unlike 21st century airliners, where the workload of the traditional flight deck crew had been largely replaced by computers, Concorde retained a traditional 1960s style cockpit. Its pilots were not only hand-picked for the role, but were acutely aware of the esteem to which they were held within the industry, especially in the US.
Well, I can clearly remember flying over the States and other aircraft saying, "Where's the Concorde?" And we'd say, and the controller would say, "Well, look at 1 o'clock, right to left. Oh, geez, isn't that a pretty sight?" And so we felt extremely flattered. We said, "Thank you so much for appreciating us." Equally in the lift, I can remember Americans getting in, seeing us all in uniform in the hotel, I suppose I ought to call it the elevator, saying, "Do you guys fly the Concorde?" And we said in our little English voices, "Yes, well, as a matter of fact, we do."
America's love affair with this quaint Anglo-French plane remained strong for three decades. Although expensive, noisy, and environmentally incorrect, Concorde was to become a regular fixture at JFK. On an average morning, two Concordes left for Paris and London, and meanwhile, another two arrived from London and Paris, all four Concordes taking the same supersonic tracks following one another across the Atlantic at 1,300 miles per hour. With only 13 Concordes between the two airlines, it was a strange phenomenon that every morning at JFK, a third of the total fleet of this extraordinary aircraft would be under power at the same time. But given the volume of business traffic flowing in and out of New York, it was no surprise that JFK had become synonymous with Concorde.
People began to realize what a marvelous machine Concorde was for crossing the Atlantic. Leave London 10:30, New York slightly before 9:30 in the morning. You've travelled backwards in time. The whole of the first day being a useful one. And so apart from the elan of actually taking Concorde, it proved to be an extremely useful tool to a businessman.
This love affair with Concorde had only started to materialise in the mid-80s. Prior to then, both airlines' supersonic fleets had struggled to break even. The government-owned airlines management regarded the planes as more of a status symbol rather than a moneymaker.
When Concorde went into service with British Airways, the management were not keen. And if you wanted to get anywhere in British Airways, you didn't show an interest in Concorde. That management soon left. It was replaced by Lord King and Sir Colin Marshall as they are now. The idea that Concorde would be a flagship gained force, so the figures on Concorde improved. We negotiated with government in the early 80s to such an extent that the government was then absolved of any financial involvement in the Concorde project. And as that happened, the costs of maintaining Concorde and maintaining a watching brief on Concorde, which the manufacturers have throughout the life of an aircraft, switched from government finance to airline finance. And from that point onwards, we never looked back.
Mark 2, twice the speed of sound.
For the first time in its history, privatisation brought with it financial independence. No longer would Concorde be run as a loss-making flagship, its future would be destined by hard economics. Thatcherism had been born, and it was to Jock Lowe that BA turned with a clear message about the jet's future. Concorde must pay, or else.
We found out that the passengers didn't know what the fare was. We also found out that they're also very senior. They were the chairman, they were the directors, they were a layer of people who were entitled to Concorde travel. So they didn't know what the fare was, and when we asked them to guess, they guessed that the fare was higher than it actually was. So we just simply began to charge them what they thought they were paying. That brought in extra money. But we also cut real costs. For instance, the number of captains came down from 31 to 19. Now that's a big saving, and we did that all round. And finally, we looked at the product. What service were we giving? Were the timings right? Were we giving too much, too little, and so on? And I suppose the final aspect of that is we started to use the aeroplane to market itself. We started to do lots of interviews telling everyone it was a success, because that's what the general public wanted to hear, that it was a success. They didn't want to hear about it losing money. And luckily, these things all came together and we began to make money. We began to make a lot of money.
With Jock Lowe at the helm, BA's Concorde balance sheet shifted from a £16 million annual loss to a £40 million profit within a year. Concorde had proved that it had two major assets that would pull in the punters: speed and charisma. With the New York operation predominantly aimed at business travellers, BA decided to try out a new tack and divert one of its lightly used weekend London-New York flights to Barbados instead. With a burgeoning tourism industry, the island was becoming increasingly popular with the rich and famous. Concorde was to prove the ultimate tool for the jet set heading to the Caribbean, as it had been for the business traveller between London and New York. But back at BA's headquarters, opinion was divided about further flight destinations.
There was a bit of a battle inside BA, because one aeroplane was on the ground and there were plans to put another one on the ground. And we said, no, we want to fly them. We're going to make money with them. We had done two charters. We had done a charter for Brian Calvert, who was the first BA pilot, for his pub in 1978, and for the Daily Mirror, 1977. But that was all. And then we said, no, this is a market. It's an achievable dream. People want to go on it.
Having won the internal battle, BA's new proactive team set to work finding willing external partners to market and charter the aircraft, leaving the airline with a risk-free and lucrative additional source of cash flow for its high-cost fleet. This formula was to prove an outstanding success for BA and its new partners.
You could fly Concorde, convince your potential buyer that it's worth buying your product. You could say thank you to your best salesman, or you could just tell Granny what a wonderful lady she was and how everybody loved her. It just had that ability. It could be used. The aircraft was a tool not just for the businessman, but for everybody else in every other walk of life. Everybody would find Concorde fitted somewhere, and they wanted to experience it and enjoy it.
But across the channel, Air France's government-backed management were to watch the success of charters in the UK with interest and ultimately boost their own books by flying a number of Paris to Paris, one-hour loop flights out over the Bay of Biscay. But at around $1,000 for a seat to end up back where you started, would this gamble pay off?
What bliss to wait at my love's door, to steal a glimpse of her beauteous form. Oh, sweet bird of man's creation, how I thrill at your splendor. Concorde, Zeppelin, what's in a name? That which we call an Airbus by any other name would fly as sweet. What romance in a radar, an airport lounge, the thrill of the wait, the scent of rubber upon runway. Oh, graceful ballet, directing your aerial dance. Oh, fertile mother, spilling forth 1,000 offspring, your cavernous belly plump with cargo. And what paradise beneath your fair skin, what comfort! Long, slender aisles stretching on and on, oh, what delicious delight! Fly, sweet bird, soar, great albatross, while I can but envy your flight.
Discovery Wings, passionate about flight.
Air France's charter programme got off to a good start. Although not as successful as in the UK, they proved popular and profitable.
It took the whole day for a one-hour flight because I would have
lunch with the passengers. I would also visit the museum with them. And after the flight, we celebrated with a cup of champagne. We had presentation of the crew and share a drink. And all the ladies would hug me and send postcards and pictures. And that was wonderful recollection, wonderful time. Totally different from the regular passengers, businessmen and show business people. When they came to visit us, it was very rewarding to see their face when they saw it and heard it the first time. And disregarding the age of the people, young or elderly, they were all enthusiastic and saying, "You're very fortunate to do such a great job." And I agree.
There's no doubt that charter passengers on Concorde almost feel as if they're going into some holy place. They've heard about Concorde, they've read about Concorde, they've seen Concorde, and now at last they're actually going to fly on Concorde to experience this twice the speed of sound, this flying to the threshold of space where the atmospheric pressure is a tenth of its value at sea level. And if you look carefully, you can just about see the curvature of the Earth.
By the mid-1990s, both BA and Air France were squeezing every last flying hour out of their respective fleets. On some weekends, in addition to the regular flights to New York, Concorde would often fly to and from JFK on charter, carrying cruise ship passengers.
We had a long-established program with Cunard, particularly with the QE2, and people would fly one way on Concorde across to New York and then go or come back on QE2. Very, very popular. I always think the QE2 is classic. It's like Concorde insofar as they came from a particular generation when you built and tested things very, very thoroughly. It's a very robust aircraft. I always think that they're two very, very special modes of transport specifically designed for that environment. Concorde has to cope with enormous temperature changes because of the sheer speed at which it flies, and it does so brilliantly. Just as a QE2 can encounter 60, 80 foot waves on the North Atlantic.
However robust, 15 years of charter flights used up valuable aircraft cycles, measured in takeoff and landings rather than total flying hours. In 1999, BA undertook a major technical assessment of its fleet. With over 8,000 cycles under each plane's belt, the writing was on the wall, particularly for short distance UK charters. Preservation for the core business route to New York became the order of the day. One of the last ever charter flights ran in July 2000 when a group of wealthy American golfers rented Concorde for a week-long tour of Scotland's premier golf courses. As the plane returned empty from Glasgow to London, BA staff there were already asking themselves whether they would get to see their airline's flagship north of the border ever again. A couple of weeks later, and a single event would change Concorde's history forever.
When I first heard the news that Concorde had crashed, it was like a blow to the gut. I couldn't believe it, and yet I had to believe it.
I was in Paris, driving back, and I was very close from Charles de Gaulle, and I saw a big, big mountain of black smoke, and I was wondering what it was, and my friend called in the car and said, "Where's Chris?" And I said, "Oh, he's in the garden, gardening." I said, "Oh, the Concorde just crashed." Couldn't believe, because for me it was impossible.
The thing I think that was profoundly shocking, as far as I'm concerned, is that I'd almost reached the rather naive position that somehow Concorde was above all the normal aerodynamic laws and that the airplane was immortal, that it never would crash.
I failed to realize it happened, because still it's something that we doubt impossible.
I first heard about the accident when my wife Chris and our daughter Amy were going on holiday. We were going across the Atlantic on the QE2 and we'd literally checked in and our baggage was in the cabin. We were walking up the gangplank for a holiday when my pager and phone went off at the same time. The message was, "Ring British Airways Operations Control urgently," and I did, and I got the first indications of what had happened. And at that stage, it was only just an indication that there had been some sort of an accident.
there was this icon that suddenly everybody had loved, and it had failed in some way. It was an extraordinary moment. And at the end of my wonders, I said to myself, I wonder if Concorde will actually fly again.
It was obviously a most unusual sequence of events, the like of which we had never either seen nor could have anticipated. And it didn't alter my basic idea that the aircraft was very safe.
My initial reaction was to call my counterpart in Air France and see if there was anything that we could do. And then get in the car and go straight back to the control centre, dropping the family off en route. And I reappeared at home 48 hours later and looked my daughter in the eye and had to apologise about the lost holiday. But I said to her, you do understand, don't you, why I'm doing this? And she said, yes, you're making sure it never happens again.
One appalling single event had dealt a serious blow to the plane's reputation. But the two airlines were to react to the tragedy in very different ways. Within 24 hours, both airlines grounded their Concordes, but while Air France kept their remaining fleet of five supersonic jets firmly on the ground indefinitely, after a major overnight check, BA decided to restart its services to New York the following day.
For Air France, the whole thing must have been utterly traumatic in a corporate sense. Traumatizing, really. And I think that explains why Air France felt they had to ground the airplane, if for no other reason than that they felt they needed to sort of get the trauma out of their system, so to speak.
Pain, a lot of pain. And you know, in 12 captains, everybody knows everybody. So you know the family, you know the children, you know the dreams of Yves Chouan, and so you know them. So
then we never fully recovered. The life has changed. It's another story. And it's no surprise they stopped the flights. You never regain the same level of confidence when you have such a tragedy.
Equally, I think it explains why British Airways felt that having put certain extra checks in place, like a runway sweep before every Concorde departure, it was perfectly reasonable and justifiable to carry on operating the aeroplane.
But with speculation mounting that a piece of metal on the runway had been responsible for the crash, the French were furious at the British decision to start flying before the full facts were known. With the Entente Cordiale at an all-time low, BA was quick to publicise its reasoning for returning the aircraft to service.
Working with the accident investigators, the manufacturers, Air France and everybody involved, we knew pretty quickly the essence of what had happened. We reviewed all that we did. Over that night, we put a lot of checks in place. We did a fleet-wide check on a number of areas, and we reviewed our decision to continue operating on a daily basis.
BA's gamble had started to pay off, with regular passengers continuing to fly on Concorde. The crash, it seemed, had done little to dent commercial confidence, even though the full facts were unknown. After 3 weeks of speculation about the exact cause, the airworthiness authorities suddenly announced that they were grounding the planes indefinitely until the problem could be fully identified. BA was surprised and shocked by the announcement.
It was a very easy matter to ground just a handful of Concordes. It wasn't going to affect a huge number of air travellers. It was going to have no impact on the global aviation scene.
And one's got to say that it would have been very difficult for the authorities to have, for instance, withdrawn the certificate of airworthiness of a Boeing 737 on the basis of a single crash, because there are so many of them flying. It was much easier in the case of Concorde, with only 12 examples flying, for that certificate of airworthiness to be withdrawn.
I think when the C of A was withdrawn for a very short time, it was a little bit of a surprise, but then immediately after that, really, the focus shifts from that to everything that needs to be done to get it back once more. I've never had any doubt that we'd succeed in getting the certificate of airworthiness reinstated and that Concorde would return to commercial flight. And it was from that moment, the very day that it happened, that our energies were pointing forwards rather than looking back.
As the fleet remained on the ground, the exact cause of the accident became more apparent. As the doomed Concorde gathered speed to take off, the piece of metal on the runway that had fallen off a previous plane cut one of the main tyres with disastrous consequences. A large piece of rubber from the tyre then hit the underside of the wing with such force that it caused a massive shockwave inside one of the main fuel tanks, which in turn punctured the lining, allowing thousands of gallons of kerosene to leak out, igniting on the afterburners. To allow Concorde to continue flying, Air France and BA were told to undertake a modification program that would cost £3 million per aircraft and would take over a year to complete.
The modifications are designed to break the chain of events in three particular ways. A new tyre, which is far more resistant to cuts, has far less energy in it if it is damaged, and is lighter. Liners inside the tanks, Kevlar liners that are bulletproof and will stop there ever being that fuel rupture again. And we've isolated ignition sources so that even if there were fuel leaking, it can't be ignited. Those three ways would work independently, each on their own. As a package together, they ensure that you could never have the series of events that led to those tragic, tragic things in Paris.
While the decision to go ahead with the modifications had been approved by both airlines, at £3 million per plane, BA decided to refit only five of its seven Concordes for its core routes to New York and Barbados. With two spare aircraft mothballed, any hopes of reprieving BA's charter program were now truly dashed. After the crash, Air France were now left with only five planes and committed to refurbing them all.
Anybody who's in business knows that you have to keep reviewing your business plans, and at some time, rather like all of us with an old car perhaps, you decide that the time has come to buy a new one or to undertake the major capital expenditure to put a new engine or whatever you want to do with it. And I think that had been an ongoing process. This obviously refocused it. The aircraft is expensive to maintain and keep running. It requires a lot of engineering man hours, and that argument was probably finally balanced. And obviously the decision was made to actually go ahead, which I think is a great vote of confidence, because I think it was a hard-nosed decision. I don't think it was done out of sentiment. I think the belief was there that it could continue to make money if it came back in service.
By summer 2001, the planes were ready to re-enter commercial service, and a number of test flights were undertaken to check out the aircraft's performance with new tyres and Kevlar linings.
For a technical assessment flight, we normally start off from base, which is just here, just outside the window here, and we're hooked up to a tug that's got a ground power unit on that gives us the power supply to run all our systems while we get our checks done before starting the main engines, and we're towed across. Just at the end here is the perimeter road that goes around the airport, and there is a crossing there, and we're towed across that crossing by the tug. We have to get air traffic control clearance, but in fact we don't as pilots do that. The tug driver does it himself, and we monitor that on our radio. The idea of the flight was to check all the normal systems out and also some of the standby systems, just so we can make sure that everything was fit for normal flight when it does go to New York carrying passengers for the first time.
Having traversed what must be the most unusual crossroads in the world, the youngest of the Concorde fleet, known as Alpha Golf, taxis out for her first flight in 15 months.
We get towed across until they bring the aircraft to a halt, they tell us to park, and then we get the ground supplies, start all four engines of course, and then we taxi away from there doing our taxi trials.
The success of that last crucial test flight determined the immediate future of the aircraft, with the return to commercial service to New York only a couple of weeks away. After touching down at Heathrow, elated after a flawless flight, the crew were greeted with shocking news. The date, September the 11th. With the terrorist attacks in America shaking confidence in airline travel across the world, BA and Air France were in a difficult position. Either write off £30 million worth of modifications or battle it out in an increasingly uncertain marketplace.
Rumours started circulating that the aircraft was going to be taken out of service, and my contacts in France were of the same opinion, and we started making inquiries of our own, and we realised that there was a lot that wasn't being said, and that generally told a story.
Concorde did return to service in the aftermath of 9/11, but was an economic disaster for the airlines, sometimes flying with passenger numbers in single digits. The writing was on the wall, and in April 2003, an announcement that would shock the industry. These extraordinary aircraft would cease flying later that year.
Concorde's about 4 years old in terms of airplane hours. She's done about the same number of takeoffs and landings as a 4 to 5 year old 737 and about the same number of hours as a 4 to 5 year old 747. So on technical terms alone, the airplane's capable of continuing for many years to come. What has happened, of course, is that for a number of economic reasons like SARS, the Iraq war, foot and mouth disease, general economic downturn, business leaders are now trading down, they're being more frugal with their travel budgets, and they were not travelling Concorde anywhere near as much as in the past.
While all French Concordes were to cease operating at the end of May, BA negotiated to prolong its flights until the end of October. An existing contract whereby both airlines shared the maintenance costs ran out then. For BA to continue flying beyond this date would have been uneconomic, so the countdown to the end of supersonic aviation was to begin.
Behold the beauty of my true love, the romance of radar, the airport lounge, the thrill of the wait. Oh, joy of rubber upon runway. What graceful ballet directs your aerial dance? Oh, spacious seating plan. Fly, sweet bird, soar, great albatross, while I can but envy your flight.
Discovery Wings, passionate about flight.
With under a month to go before the end of Air France flights, interest in Concorde was at an all-time high.
The demand from that point on was incredible. Our phone lines just did not stop ringing. We chartered six extra Air France flights just to fill in the space between then and the end of May, and we were selling New York.
While Air France had been keen to get rid of the planes as soon as possible, BA were actively promoting the last few months of Concorde service. But as the French bowed out at the end of May, the reaction from the French public was truly underestimated.
Surprisingly enough, at the end, everyone in France seemed to be getting ever so passionate about Concorde. As soon as they knew it wasn't going to be there anymore, they suddenly all fell in love with it. I think in Britain, we fell in love with it when it first flew and stayed in love with it. And the demand was always much greater on this side of the channel.
I would say that the French people, like Latin, just give their heart. When they saw Concorde flying and taking off, it's such a beautiful, powerful show that all the lovers, Concorde lovers, were holding their breath.
Whether French or British, Concorde seems to have inspired a unique sense of almost uncontrollable passion amongst those who have been lucky enough to fly on her or simply watch as she soared through the air. But for the pilots, there was always a special bond.
The aeroplane was an absolute delight to fly. It handled beautifully. And I think that's a remarkable tribute to be able to say that about an aeroplane. And remember, we're talking about an aeroplane that was being designed in the late 1950s, mid-1960s. We're talking about 40-year-old technology. Here we are now in the 21st century, and it remains unique.
I had the most expensive hobby going, and someone was paying me to do it. And I've had experiences that I could simply not have dreamt of. And this overlaying pride and excitement that goes with Concorde. So I feel very, very privileged and very lucky to have flown it for as long as I did.
It is an immense privilege, and we felt it. We knew we were flying faster and higher, and we saw the thunderstorm below us pass our way rapidly. and we knew we were flying faster than the sun, and it's a miracle we never got used to. I always been in great admiration of this aircraft and of the speed.
I spent 15 years on that aeroplane and I never once drove up to Heathrow feeling that I wished I wasn't doing it. There was always that eager anticipation that I was about to get back into the flight deck of my favourite aeroplane. I mean, I've flown well over 70 different types of aeroplanes, including helicopters and seaplanes and all sorts of things. And there is nothing that compares with Concorde. It comes into a very special category. It's the Grand Prix racing car, the Epsom Derby winner of the flying world, without any doubt at all.
We got out to the aircraft in the morning. It was a lovely New York morning, as only those mornings can be, fresh, lovely bright blue sky, and a smashing flight back. Smooth flying conditions, wonderful visibility, and came back to London also on a lovely, clear, calm evening. And I thought, if you've got to finish, that's the way to do it. Quick kick of the tyres when you leave, and then the realisation you're not going to do it again.
I really had withdrawal symptoms for, I don't know, a year, 18 months, and eventually I sort of had to pull myself together and say, come on, Hutchinson, there are other things to do, and another life to be got on with. But, you know, initially, for the first year or so, I really was a very, pretty grumpy old man.
Concorde's retirement, as well as sparking emotions, raise questions about the future of supersonic aviation. Will the Concorde years be remembered as a costly one-off experiment at the expense of the British and French taxpayers, or for technical achievement to be built upon by future generations?
Clearly, at the moment, for the very reasons that we've retired Concorde, there's not the commercial drive to develop a second-generation supersonic, because the business isn't there, which is why we've retired the aeroplane. But at some stage, when the economic cycle turns and the manufacturers get profits from their major subsonic projects that are going through now, customers start coming back, business picks up, that's the time when a next-generation supersonic will be reconsidered. I think it'll be a slightly different animal to Concorde, probably about the same speed, maybe a little slower, certainly have a longer range, trans-Pacific, probably carry more passengers. Now, an aeroplane that can deliver that and also appeal to the leisure market may well be sustainable over a long period of time. That, together with the technological challenges, puts it beyond the 10-year gap, but I'm convinced it'll come. I don't envisage that at some point in my future, my daughter, who's now 9, will be saying to her children, you remember when Granddad used to cross the Atlantic in 3.5 hours and it now always takes 8.5? The human race has never taken backward steps for very long, and I'm absolutely convinced personally that we'll see a successor to Concorde.
Opinion is divided as to what the future holds for civil supersonic planes. Concorde's withdrawal has had virtually no effect on the lives of the majority of air travellers. But for the tiny minority of regular passengers used to travelling across the Atlantic in just over 3 hours, this national icon will be sadly missed.
It seems that it is a huge opportunity that's being missed to keep what is an icon of magnificent engineering. British, we always see it as being a British aircraft, the French will see it as a French aircraft. It was a joint effort, but a fantastic bit of British engineering nevertheless. For that now to be just a museum piece is an absolute tragedy. And it is such a shame that one of the aircraft couldn't be kept flying for display purposes, just to see it flying in the air, which is a wonderful experience in itself, or to keep a few flying, just to for people still to be able to experience that incredible sensation of flying supersonic on a commercial aircraft. That's it now. There aren't any others, and there probably won't be for our lifetime.